Upon the earth, and though this body be destroyed, yet shall I see God, whom I shall see for myself, and my eyes shall behold, and not as a stranger. We brought nothing into this world, and it is certain we can carry nothing out. The Lord gave, and the Lord hath taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. You may be seated. And let us say together the Psalms in alternating verses as pointed in the bulletin, beginning with Psalm 19. I'll read the first verse and please respond to the second verse and so forth. Again, thou sayest, come again, ye children of men.
For a thousand years from thy sight are as yesterday, and as a blotch in the night.
As soon as thou scatterest them, they are even as in a sleep, and fade away suddenly like the grass.
This song is written in the 8th chapter of St. Paul's Epistle to the Romans, beginning at the 14th verse. As many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are called the sons of God. For ye have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear, but ye have received the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit himself beareth witness with our spirit, that we are the children of God. And if children, then heirs, heirs of God, and joint heirs of Christ, if so be that we suffer with him, that we may also be glorified together. For I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall come, which shall be revealed in us. For the earnest expectation of the creature waiteth for the manifestations of the sons of God. We know things to come, nor height nor depth, nor any other creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus, our Lord. Hear any of that, dear soul.
Thanks be to God.
And let us stand for the reading of the Holy Gospel. The Gospel is written in the 14th chapter of the Gospel according to St. John, beginning at the first verse. Glory be to thee, O Lord. Jesus said, "Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there ye may be also. And whither I go, ye know, and the way ye know." Thomas saith unto him, "Lord, we know not whither thou goest, and how can we know the way?" Jesus saith unto him, "I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man cometh unto the Father but by me."
Praise be to thee, O Christ.
You may be seated. At this time, I'd like to welcome Jacob Richards, who would like to give a tribute for the family.
She modeled self-sacrificial love as she endured more than 100 chemotherapy treatments, several major surgeries, and multiple lengthy hospital stays. Even when the odds were slim and the side effects were brutal, she did everything she could to be there for her family. Despite her condition, Mom never wallowed in self-pity or gave into despair. Instead, true to form, she was the spiritual and emotional rock that the rest of us leaned on, as we dealt with our own waves of doubt, anger, and fear. In the depths of her suffering, she was there for us as only a mother could be. Not only was she there for us, her doctors and nurses leaned on her too. Her initial hospital stay lasted nearly a month. During that time, we watched multiple nurses break down and cry as they got to know Mom and learn of her condition. But somehow, even amid the shock of her diagnosis, Mom seized the opportunity to lift her nurses up and share her faith with them. In her 4 weeks under their care, she got to know several of the nurses, praying with them, asking about their families, and brightening their days whenever they walked by. Later on, one of her oncologists revealed that his wife had just received her own stage 4 colon cancer diagnosis. Mom was quick to lend her support, praying with him, sending books and letters to his wife. And towards the end of Mom's treatment, when that same doctor had prayed the news that her time was running short, Mom retained her composure and had comforting words for her doctor as he cried. And right up until her final days, Mom held on to her ability to find joy in small things. Just a few weeks ago, after spine tumors had robbed her of the use of her legs, She had enrolled at Hope Hospice to her. Mom got a new TV. And I'll never forget walking into her room one morning to check on her, only to find her blasting 80s music videos, idly dancing to bed, reveling in Austin's and my embarrassment at the corny music she so enjoyed. 100 more years with Mom would not have been long enough to exhaust all the lessons we've learned from her. But I'm grateful for the time we had, for the example she set, and for the honor of being her son.
Stand together and say the Nicene Creed on page 71. Page 71. I believe in one God, Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten. I am the resurrection and the life, saith the Lord. He that believeth in me, though he were dead, yet shall he live. And whosoever liveth and believeth in me shall never die. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. Thank you, Jacob, for your tribute to your mother, and I can testify the same. Sherry lifted me up over the last 6 years as I got to know her and minister to her, and she was a tremendously strong woman in the faith, and it was a great blessing to be able to minister to her in her dying days and to give her the last rites that she might receive the final absolution in preparation for her holy death. And today we gather as the faithful to pray for the repose of the soul of Sherry, that God might receive her into the glorious company of the saints in light, where she may go from strength to strength in the life of perfect service. Now, we do this, gather as friends and family. We do this right before the great festival of Christmas. And of course, it may be difficult to reconcile grief that we have with the festivities of the coming feast. How do you combine those two? But I will suggest that if we look at the reason for Christmas and focus on the essence of that feast and why there is a feast, we will find great comfort and strength. Because what we are celebrating is the coming of the Redeemer in time, when God himself in the person of his Son entered into human history and became one of us in Jesus Christ. So the Christ child is born. The great message of the angels is to bring glad tidings of great joy to all people, because unto them is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. And so that is the essence of the feast, and we will see that. If we see the all of the bright lights that we use to decorate for the feast of Christmas, that reminds us of the light of the world. It's but a symbol to lead us to the great understanding of the gospel, that the light has come among us. That light who is the true light of God, God of God, light of light, very God of very God. That light which has come into the darkness, and the darkness cannot overwhelm it. And so Christ is that true light, and in him we find our true enlightenment. We are brought out of darkness into his own glorious light. You see the testimony given by those who are eyewitnesses, that they beheld his glory, the glory as of the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. And so let us see the little lights that we put together for Christmas. Let us be reminded of Christ, who is the light of the world, who has come to bring light to those who sit in darkness and in the shadow of death, as the great day spring from on high, to bring light to them, and to bring them out of the shadow of death. And so we commend Sherry to this great one who has come among us. We commend her soul to this one who is light, the light of heaven. We also see at Christmas time, it is a time for gathering. We gather friends and family for the feast. It is a time to get together. And this reminds us of the communion that God desires with us. He has brought the Redeemer into the world to bring us out of sin and sadness and into communion with him. There is this birth of the Redeemer who will do his work of redemption, and through that work reconcile us to God. He brings the atonement, the atonement, to bring us back to God and to bring God back to us, to bridge us together, to join us together again in an indivisible union. And so we trust in this for the time of death, that that union is stronger than death, and that we, though there be any other power, there's no other power great enough to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord. And so we trust in that union. And by the faith and by the sacraments of the church, we are now joined together with God through Christ and brought together with him in a union which will transcend death itself. And so we trust in that today. We come together as a people of faith who have hope beyond the grave, a sure and certain hope. For Christ himself has gone into heaven itself to prepare a place for us. And where he is, there he shall also be. And so we are now awaiting that time for our own selves. We see, we commemorate today the passage of one of us into glory. So it might be we can call it her graduation. She's now passed from this life into the next, crossed over Jordan. She's part of that host that is crossed over, and some are crossing now, and then will cross over. She has graduated now to paradise and is beyond the pains and difficulties of this life. So there is great comfort, we think, on these things, that her union with Christ is bringing her beyond what she suffered in this life. There is no cancer where Sherry is now. She's beyond that. That was a chapter. That chapter is over. She's graduated from that now. She's beyond that now. She's now with Christ in a state of glory where there is no more pain, where God himself is wiping away her tears, where her own sorrowful sadness of life is being washed away in the brightness of Jesus' glory. And so, hallelujah, we're very comforted by that. And Christmas will remind us of that in the gathering of friends and family. Let us not be afraid of that in our grief. Let us enter into that and see in it but a symbol of the great union that God is establishing with us. And in that union, find our great strength and our comfort in our loss. We also
is a celebration of joy that many people will use the Christmas tree. And what is a Christmas tree after all? What a symbol. What is that tree? An evergreen, a symbol of eternal life. And so let us see, whenever we see this Christmas tree, let us be reminded of the hope that we have of eternal life. For Christ has come to break the bonds of death, and he has done all things well. We see in his own life the opening out of the kingdom of heaven, that where Christ is, there is no sickness. People come to him with disease, and he heals them. This is but an intimation of what he will bring in the great miracle of his resurrection, when after 3 days dead, he rises again in a glorified state, and then communes with his apostles for 40 days, and then ascends up into glory. There is this fact of the resurrection that we proclaim as Christians when we gather on the Lord's Day, and indeed we'll declare it now in our offering of the Holy Communion. And we will participate even now in the glory of that resurrection through the means of the sacrament, where we receive the very body of the living Lord under the forms of bread and wine. All of you, by the way, are welcome to receive this sacrament, which is our pledge of life eternal. And come forward, and I will communicate by intinction. So open your mouth wide, and I will fill it. Excuse me. And there is the gift that we have even now in our greeting of God, who is strengthening us, supporting us, upholding us, surrounding us with his love, and giving us the means of strength through the sacramental grace that is ours in the communion of the Lord's Supper. Here we receive life himself, God, who will strengthen us by this bread of heaven which Christ came to give us, that in him we too might partake of eternal life. And so on this day where we gather at the death of Sherry, let us see it as her graduation day. Let us see it as a day to be reminded of those eternal truths which are ours by faith. And let us be strengthened by the light of Christ, by his presence in us, in our communion with him, and by his life, that indestructible life which overwhelms the enemy of death. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Amen. I'll explain again that all are welcome to communion. If you decide not to receive communion, you can make the St. Andrew's cross like this, and I'll give you a blessing. But do come forward for that blessing. After the service, we'll sing the final hymn as pointed in the bulletin. And after that hymn, we'll have a processional out to the columbarium and the committal service. Sherry will be buried in our columbarium in the courtyard. So we'll have a committal service immediately following here. And then you're welcome to come up to Dorothy's Hall for a light lunch and join the family and express your condolences and love for them. So we'll enter now standing with prayers for Sherry, and then enter into the offering of this Requiem Mass. Let us stand.
Almighty God.
beseech thee also so to direct and dispose the hearts of all Christian rulers, they may truly and impartially administer justice to the punishment of wickedness and vice, and to the maintenance of thy true religion and virtue. Give grace, O heavenly Father, to all bishops and other ministers, they may both by their life and doctrine set forth thy true and lively word, rightly and duly administer thy holy sacraments. To all thy people give thy heavenly grace, and especially to this congregation here present, that with meek heart and reverence they may hear and receive thy holy word, truly serving thee in holiness and righteousness all the days of their life. And we most humbly beseech thee of thy goodness, O Lord, to comfort and succor all those who in this transitory life are in trouble, sorrow, need, sickness, or any other adversity. And we also bless thy holy name for all thy servants to depart to this life in thy faith and fear, especially Sherry, beseeching thee to grant them continual growth in thy law and service, and to give us grace so to follow their good examples that with them we may be partakers of thy heavenly kingdom. Grant this, O Father, for Jesus Christ's sake, our only mediator and advocate.
Ye who do truly and earnestly repent of your sins and are in love and charity with your neighbors and intend to lead a new life, following the commandments of God and walking from henceforth in his holy ways, draw near with faith and take this holy sacrament to comfort and make your humble confession to Almighty God devoutly kneeling.
Kneel for these prayers at page 75. Almighty God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, make your all things judge and honor. We acknowledge to you that our manifold sins and wickedness, which we from time to time most grievously have committed, by thought, word, and deed, against the sight of thy majesty, provoking most justly thy wrath and indignation against us. We do the mercy.
So God loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son to the end that all that believe in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Hear also what St. Paul said. This is a true saying and worthy of all men to be received, that Christ Jesus came into the world to save sinners. Hear also what St. John said. If any man sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ, the righteous, and he is the propitiation for our sins.
The Lord be with you.
And with thy spirit.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up unto the Lord.
Let us give thanks unto our Lord God.
It is meet and right so to do.
It is very meet, right in our bounden duty. We should at all times and in all places give thanks unto thee. O Lord, Holy Father, Almighty, everlasting God, through Jesus Christ our Lord, in whom have been manifested forth unto us the hope of a glorious resurrection, giving unto those who bewail the certain condition of their mortality bore the sins of the whole world, and in his institute and in his holy gospel command us to continue a perpetual memory of that his precious death and his sacrifice until his coming again. For the night in which he was betrayed, he took bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to his disciples, saying, "Take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. Do this us pray.